Any question from last lecture, a set of rules and things like that? Did you try quantizing the driven resonator with a current? Did it work for you? Okay. Anyway, so I'm going to remind you a little bit what came out of the example we had a look at, which was a driven resonator, because it contains some physics that we will need eventually. So it was LC resonator coupled to a voltage source. And what it did, it was that through this capacitance, it influenced the amount of charge that was stored here. So having a voltage here could favor having some additional or less charge on this capacitor. The sign and the amount of it was determined by V, because the Hamiltonian in the end, it looked like the like this, where QG was proportional to the gate voltage. So what we were doing is that we were shifting the minimum of this parabola, okay? So initially it was around charge equals zero, and now it's around QG. And this idea will pop up again when we study charge qubit. But even if we don't reach that, you see already here that you have a coupling more precisely, you can write down the expression for the capacitance, so the, for the charge reference, so that you have the LC resonator plus 1, 2 something like this, where VG is an external source of voltage, which can be time dependent. So this procedure doesn't depend on whether V is constant or not. So when you quantize this, if you remember what we had some expressions for the flux and the charge in terms of Fock operators, this turns into a harmonic oscillator with some external driving. Where this is proportional to VG, to the constants that we had there, and well, it was the other one, this is charge, and so on. So in principle, you can derive microscopically the strength of the driving. The frequency of the driving is determined by your source. But what you have is basically a resonator with frequency omega that is subject to an external force that whose magnitude is omega. P and X are interchangeable in this picture. And so this is a driven resonator. You know that a driven resonator is not stable. You can put as much energy as you want there. If this guy oscillates with this frequency, in a rotating frame with this frequency, what this will achieve is that in position, well, this is charge phase space, this is rotating with some frequency omega. If you move to a rotating frame, this will simply take your initial state, which can be a vacuum, and move it in a given direction as a function of time. So it simply displaces it when omega of t is omega zero some cosine. So it's resonant. So that's not a very useful picture in general. This is not going to be like that. We don't want just the system to blow up. We will have typically that this is more like this kind of devices. You have some external source of voltage, and you couple the same oscillator to some measurement device and study the response of the oscillator. So you are monitoring what happens to the resonator in time. And that means that it's not just in this picture, it's not just an external driving influence in the resonator. You also have losses because radiation can leak out in both senses with some decay rates induced by the environment. So that's more or less it. So the we are going to model this now, but before that, one of you asked me a question about the internal losses of this resonator, and that's something that is going to pop up again when we look at waveguides. So these devices, I am assuming the perfect quality, so this is just an ideal resonator if I remove this and this. So this, you put energy into it and it's never lost. There are different ways to consider the fact that photons don't live infinitely in the resonator. One way, which is usual in electrical circuit theory, would be to add some effective resistance to it. The problem with this approach is that the equations that you get are not conservative. So there is not an associated Lagrangian to it because, I mean, the energy is not conserved there. So you cannot find a Lagrangian that describes this resonator. And so it's not a convenient way to work towards quantization. So instead, what we do is to treat the resonator with an environment. So this leads to a quantum Hamiltonian, which is coupled to an environment. This means it's an open quantum system. And then, well, from here you can go, for instance, to master equations, or to whatever formalism you want to treat this open quantum system. And you see it's more or less obvious here. So in this case, it's clear that we have an environment because we have a connection to a voltage source and a connection to a measurement device. And this already decreases the quality of the resonator because photons can leak out through these two ports. Okay? They can be injected, but they can also leak out. In addition to this, we could assume that you have an additional environment with some additional decay rate induced by the coupling, for instance, to the substrate, to trap charges, or to whatever source of decoherence that you can think that is part of your system, like in 3D cavities. You could have spurious currents on the cavity or whatever. But so basically what we do is we assume that the circuit is ideal, perfect conductor and superconducting device without resistance. And then we introduce this resistance in the form of a coupling to the environment. There's a very nice derivation in the notes of the Bourret where he shows the equivalence between a semi-infinite transmission line and an absorbing medium. So it's like an environment or resistance for the system. And that's more or less our approach. So let me continue with this example of a driven oscillator because we are going to use it later on when we move to cavity QED. So as I told you that we model this with two ingredients. One is that we assume a coupling to an environment, and we then treat that coupling in some perturbative way. So typically we take, I'm not going to do the derivation here, we will use it later for qubits in open lines, but just to show you more or less how we work with this in quantum optics. So you have the Hamiltonian of the LC resonator, you have some interaction, and you have a buff, which in this case it includes the driving. You can have the measurement device, and so on. And we treat this up to second order perturbation theory, which amounts to having a master equation. For the LC resonator. So the equation typically reads like this. You have that, now you have to work with a density matrix because you're no longer in a pure state. And you have can you read this? Is it large enough in the back? You have a Hamiltonian part and a part that describes the losses. The Hamiltonian part is relatively simple. It contains your original oscillator, and now we will include the possibility of having some driving, which we write in the most general form like this. So you have some time-dependent Rabi frequency that acts on the Fock operators. And the losses, well, in this case, I'm only going to consider losses induced by the coupling to this measurement device and the sources. So we have a total decay rate . So kappa is has the units of frequency or inverse of time, and is the decay rate of the resonator, is the rate at which it loses photons into the in these devices. Okay. Yes, because I divided everything by H bar. Sorry. I'm never self-consistent with myself. So. This is very, very nice because from here you can fully describe the time dependence of rho. I told you the other day that if you start with a Gaussian state and you have this linear coupling to the bath and you don't introduce any other ingredients, rho of t remains Gaussian. So it can be described just by a few moments, which could be, for instance, these three. So you only need to find out equations for these guys. The way you do it is that you recall what this means. So expectation value of an operator is the trace of this operator with a density matrix. You can differentiate this in time. So you can have the Schrödinger equation for the density matrix, replace this expression that you have here, and use the fact that the trace is cyclic. So you would have expressions like this, and this is converted into C A B rho. So that at the end you can go back to always traces of some operators with the same density matrix. So that's very usual approach. And in that language you have that, for instance, the equation for the quadratures is just rotations in phase space. Now you have that these rotations can be also have an exponentially decaying component, so that A is attenuated and pushed towards the origin. And you have this driving, omega of t, which when it is resonant with omega can lead to an explosion of A. The number of photons gets rid of these phases, and it only depends on your decay rate. And on the driving, and you could have the other quadratures and so on. So basically, kappa in this case is the rate at which you lose photons, and also the rate at which you break the evolution of the A value. And that's the is something that we can solve analytically for many useful drivings, like sinusoidal oscillations of omega. But the other nice thing is that when the system decays, it does so because it emits radiation through the ports through which it's being driven or measured. So there are also some additional input output relations that they can be derived formally, but what they tell you is that the field that is coming out of these cables contains information about the quantum statistics of the field that is inside the resonator. So you have that, for instance, if I look at this cable, I would have some electromagnetic field coming in and then bouncing back. And this field that bounces back carries information about the incoming field, which would be in this case the driving, but also about a small fraction of the quadratures of the LC resonator. Okay? So that's what allows us, for instance, that here, in this case, you would have that what you enter in is with vacuum, assuming that there is no thermal radiation, and what you come out is with the square root of A plus vacuum. So if you can calibrate out these vacuum fluctuations, you can, in the measurement device, extract information about the statistics and correlations of the operator. So you can study the dynamics of the resonator in real time. That's something that can be done. So how does it look like? So this is a very trivial exercise in quantum mechanics, but it's useful for various reasons. So I can integrate the equation for A, for instance. Check out here. So you have that the displacement of the oscillator is rotating in time, and it's being driven by this gate voltage. I get rid of vacuum fluctuations of the incoming field. And so this guy, you integrate it in time, I'm going to call it alpha of time. It's simply like this, and I'm going to assume that this guy is some constant, and then I put here deriving with some possible phase, and this can be solved analytically. So what happens is that forgetting about these transients, what you get at the end is that this goes like
alpha is?
It's the expectation value here.
Oh.
It's just a number. I just it's no longer an operator. It's just more or less the expectation value, which is going to be related to the expectation values of voltage and intensity here in the measurement device. I could study higher order statistics of this, but I'm just focusing on this. We could also, instead of working with expectation values, we could work with operators, but then you would have Langevin equations, you would have to consider the vacuum noise and things like that. I thought it was the easiest thing. So basically what happens is that even though the resonator has a proper frequency, in the end, because it's being driven by an external source, what at the end it does is it oscillates with the frequency of that external source, and with an amplitude that depends on the difference between the driving frequency and the resonator frequency. Okay? So you have a typical Lorentzian profile for alpha squared, which is related to the power. So you have the resonator frequency and a Lorentzian profile, which probably somebody can paint better. And the half width of this is simply the decay rate of the resonator. But there is another ingredient which typically one doesn't regard, which is the fact that alpha contains a phase. And this does like this. Okay. Well, this asymptotically goes down to zero. So information that you get. So you get information about what is the resonance of the resonator. Okay, this is what you get spectroscopically just from the power that you measure at the output, the transmitted power through the resonator. If you are far away from the resonance frequency, no power is transmitted. This is what it's telling you. But you also get information about the phase at which this oscillator resonates. Okay. Apart from the original phase that you put into the driving, there is an additional phase that comes from this term that depends on where you sit in frequency space. Okay? Phase shift depends on which side of the resonance you are. And this seems a bit irrelevant, but we will see that in some situations where we have more complicated circuits with qubits inside, we will use this phase to make an on-demolition measurement of the state of the qubit inside the resonator. So this phase is important for those purposes. And as I told you, you can study higher order correlations of these operators and predict what would be the measurement outcomes of this device. If we have time, we will have a look at it. And this is mostly work done by Enrique Solano and the group of Rudolf Gross, and then also Andreas Balraff use these ideas in experiments. Okay. Clear so far? We are going to switch gears now to go back again to circuit quantization of other devices. Okay, then you shouldn't go to sleep. Okay. Maybe I'm going to pose you now one of the problems that I will ask you to do before we move on to this. Let me copy the okay. It's a relatively simple problem. Just applying the ideas that we saw the other day regarding the rules of quantization. We'd like you to just study how two LC resonators can be coupled to each other. Okay. So basically you're going to have a circuit that looks like this. In principle, well, the resonators can be identical. It doesn't really matter. You can do it in a more general way. And you have some gate capacitance that is coupling both of them. So what you have to find is the effective Hamiltonian, and also quantize it, and also express the coupling. In terms of a dagger and so on. So you will see that the coupling between the resonators has various consequences, including the renormalization of the properties of each resonator. The coupling can be expressed in terms of A and A dagger. It's going to, it has to be linear. If you don't get that, you made a mistake. And that's it.
Are identical to the resonator? Same frequency, same capacitance, and
reductance? It depends on how lazy you are. If you want to, you can do it for different resonators, but I just wrote them equal because what this this is basically the foundations of coupled cavities. Okay, so what you would have in a more general context is that you have LC resonators that are coupled to each other capacitively. Things like this.
What is the box?
This would be one LC resonator, another LC resonator, with their own frequencies. And they are coupled by capacitances, okay? I mean, if you feel compelled to do that, you can do this. This is not much more difficult, but you have to be careful with the fact that this is not just two, but it's a chain. Okay? So it's not so obvious what happens with the capacitive coupling in this context. That's the part A of the problem, and the part B is slightly different, and it introduces something that falls outside the rules that I gave you before. Because I was telling you, okay, you have these inductances that are these circuital elements that are coupled together by some nodes forming a tree. But now we are going to study a different problem. Will be this LC resonator. They are identical, okay? I'm not going to assume anything else. But now I am going to assume that these two loops influence each other. Okay? So you have that this guy has a current that creates a flux on this other guy, and vice versa. And just to be consistent. I'm going to assume that the change is linear, and the flux that this guy sees is proportional to the current of this guy, and vice versa. The constant has to be the same for both of them.
This VA would be the external one?
Yes, so this is the external of, this would be circuit A and circuit B, A and B. And they influence each other.
The mutual inductance is M.
Yes. I don't want you to complicate your life too much. If you want, you can do it in full generality. If not, you can stay up to order 1 in the ratio M over L, and you get a linear coupling. If not, you can study a little bit better the consequences of these couplings. So this introduces an ingredient that is not in the rules I gave you before, but it's something that sometimes has to be taken into account. The fact that when you have nearby loops, they can influence each other through the magnetic field. There is something even worse, is that one loop can influence itself through the magnetic field it generates, because the magnetic flux that goes through this can be proportional to the current that it has, and we may get to see that for squids later on. So far we have seen just the simplest example of this. Any question? Well, maybe I can just do it here, no? Can I? Okay. There was an LC resonator. I assume that I have some capacitor and some inductor, which could be a cable, whatever. But now we are going to move to waveguides, which are macroscopic structures that transport photons through them. These are physical entities, so they are big objects, well, big for the compared to what we use in atomic physics. And they have some spatial structure. It can be, for instance, one ground plane. This is connected to zero voltage and a strip of metal on top of it. It's called strip line, microstrip. Or you can have that you can increase the quality factor of this transmission by putting additional ground planes that confine the electromagnetic field really within these boundaries. That would be for two-dimensional setups. For 3Ds, you can have three-dimensional holes or tubes fabricated in superconducting or normal metals that confine the electromagnetic field in 3D structures. This is mostly 1D, and we can neglect the transverse dependence of the field because exciting transverse modes in this structure is very expensive in terms of energy, and mostly the excitations are longitudinal. But here you can have many more modes, and they have to be taken into consideration. And so, this is to say that now what happens is that, as I told you at the beginning of the course, the tricky part is to write down a circuit that describes this. And in this case, you see that for this is going to be really an effective model. Okay? There's no circuit here, it's just a 3D structure with lots of modes. And we will associate oscillators to them, and we'll associate losses and so on. For this is a bit more justified, and we will have a look at it, how you can think about this 1D structure as being infinitesimal inductors and capacitors, describing the inductive energy along the cable and also the capacitance between these and these planes and so on, capacitive energy. But in general, this is always going to be an effective theory. So that's something I have to keep in mind. So there are really many variations of this. Somehow the community seems to be settled around either these structures, or now it's very popular to use 3D structures. This seems to have better quality factors than those, because you have a ground plane surrounding it and confine the electromagnetic field better. Here you could have radiation really to other directions on the material. So that's something that you will see in the literature. But what all these elements have in common is that they are the microwave equivalent of things that we know from optics. So these are waveguides or cavities, which are devices that confine the electromagnetic field, photons, in one or zero dimensional structures. So in this context, what you have is basically plates of superconductor, where the electromagnetic field is confined, simply because of the boundary conditions that are imposed by these superconducting materials. In optics, you would have a bit more complicated situation, where you have different materials with different refractive indices, and it's internal reflections that sustain the propagation of waves in quasi one-dimensional structures. What both of these situations have in common is that basically we have just one transverse degree of freedom. The wave function here is fixed. The wave function here is fixed, whatever psi of x. And we only regard the longitudinal dependence. So we will have basically waves propagating along this direction. Okay? So that's an approximation, but it's a very good one. Okay, so now let's write or draw just in 5 minutes what would be the equivalent circuit of this object here. What we do is we have a look at just one segment of it. Equivalent so you have something like a piece of the one-dimensional structure, where the contrary to what I draw here, the fields don't change much because the wavelengths are going to be much larger than this size. So what happens when you look at this picture is that you see that within these two plates you have two types of energy confined. You have magnetic energy and you have the electric energy associated to electric potential. And we describe this in a LC resonator with an inductive term, and we describe this in the LC resonator with a capacitive term. So somehow we will associate to this segment some inductance per unit length multiplied by the length of this segment, and a capacitance per unit length multiplied by the size of this segment. And this, in principle, could be, for instance, it can be estimated using console or I remember the other name of it's a program specifically for inductances, but it's something that you can estimate geometrically. Depends also on the properties of the material that you're working with. And we are going to build a theory out of the chain of this circuit. So we will have a model that consists on a chain of coupled LC resonators, where each of these units are of the nature I mentioned before. Okay. In principle, you could again put here some additional resistance and consider internal losses, but we are not going to do that. Okay? And we work on this after the break. Okay, so let's now take that circuit that I wrote before, effective model, and quantize it. And the first thing that you have to do, as I told you yesterday, Wednesday, is that you have to find out a tree that covers all possible nodes without creating loops. In this case, because all ground points are associated to the same value of the flux, this looks more like a collection of branches stemming from the same point, each of them going to a different intersection, okay? And then they will be closed by the inductances. There is no trap flux because this is actually a fake circuit in the end. There is no loop covering here, okay? You have your two-dimensional structure, so it's just that we use this to realize how many independent variables we have. So this is a bit like a field, a continuous field that is defined over this discrete lattice. So in principle, we are going to also to interchangeably work with this continuous field and the discrete values that it takes on these intersections, depending on what we are interested in. But we can start just by looking at the equations for the Kirchhoff equations for this system. So I have already written the arrows for the convention I'm going to use. This intensity is coming here, and part of it diverts towards the ground plane, and part of it continues on. Okay? So I simply write that the capacitor intensity is the difference between these two guys. And now I have to replace the capacitances and fluxes. So for this node, I know that the current is proportional. The current goes down, the voltage is up. So the current is simply phi I minus this flux, which is zero, second derivative. And this capacitance, I said before, there is going to be some capacitance per unit length times the discretization step. And now I have these two currents, and again I have to put the conventions that I wrote before. Phi I this, where now is this guy that it can be expressed in terms of an intensive quantity. So this is basically a model of chained oscillators. Okay? So you see that this would be your kinetic term, and this would be the restoring force of one oscillator and the restoring force of the other one, basically. Okay? And it's like the model for a string in a guitar, or for a chain of springs, or anything you want to think about it. So the equation is takes this form. That would be one. This is one equation that we are going to use, but for computing the Lagrangian, it's easier to look at this one, okay? Because you know that this is what you have, and this is the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to the flux. So you can see that this comes basically from phi I minus phi I plus 1 squared, but this also comes from phi I minus 1 squared. So the Lagrangian that you have is a sum over nodes and a sum over node differences. Or something like this. Okay. Well, the good thing about this model is that the definition of the charge remains local. So Q of I is simply the derivative of this guy with respect to phi dot C 0 delta x phi I. Okay. And you can see that roughly this is like a charge density. Okay, because delta x is a length. When you use this quantity, the Hamiltonian is just which is expressing the fact that we like to have the flux differences remain together. So the minimum of the energy is from phi I is equal to phi I plus 1 or minus 1. It doesn't matter. Just let's be consistent. And then you have the quantum fluctuations due to the charge. Okay? This is not too difficult to follow, okay? Now we simply we can massage this in various form. I'm going to do it. I'm going to show you the same thing in different forms. Some of them we will use them to compute things. Some of them we will use them simply to write the Hamiltonian and show you analogies with other models. So the first thing that you can do is you can take the continuum limit of this Hamiltonian. Basically, what you do is you say rho I is qi over delta x, and this is a continuous field, and phi I is again a continuous field. Assume that excitations are going to be long wavelength so that they don't see these differences. You can replace sums with integrals in the usual way. Sum of I delta x will go to the integral in delta x. And the Hamiltonian then reads and the original commutation relations, which were phi I, qi, I h bar, are now phi x rho x ih bar x prime. So it's like a quantum field theory. It's linear, but it's one that you will find a lot in theoretical physics, condensed matter. This theory could be made nonlinear. How would you do it? Experimentally.
Okay.
You could replace your plates by junctions. Yeah? And then you would have nonlinear inductances that would enter that picture. That's used, for instance, in making now long chains of junctions for parametric amplification or for other purposes. It turns out, however, that it's very convenient to keep this model of chained harmonic oscillators also for computational purposes when you want to do the kind of simulations I showed you yesterday in my talk about propagating photons. We do them assuming a discrete model because at the end it's very hard to work with a continuum of modes. Okay? For numerics or even sometimes for theory purposes, it's hard to work with continuous quantities. So we can do follow with a model of discrete chained LC resonators and find out consequences of that model. And we will see that then we recover this again as a low energy limit. So the other approach simply looks for, I showed you that you have the Lagrangian and you can build the Hamiltonian. That's one quantization procedure and then you go to a continuum limit. There is another approach that you can use, which would be that instead of starting from a circuit, building L and building H and making it quantum, you can start from a circuit, you can find out the eigenmodes, assuming that the theory is linear, and eigenfrequencies, and then go quantum. Okay? You would have that you look for all possible frequencies that are allowed in your linear circuit, as you would do in quantum optics. Do you now say these frequencies are going to be quantized? So I'm going to inject energy in these modes in a quantum manner. That's convenient because now what we can do is we can take this circuit with these differential equations that I showed you before, and I can find all the stationary states, stationary solutions of that circuit. So they will be typically of the form phi I of t, some distribution, and some frequency. That's the one I want to find. And when you replace this solution into the second order differential equation, you find just a simple relation that establishes what has to be the spatial dependence for this particular frequency. Let's assume that you have an infinite line. Okay, you have as many nodes as you want. That means we don't have to care about boundary conditions, and you can simply put psi of I equal to I k delta x times I, psi of j. To avoid confusion, so we have a plane wave, and your frequencies then are simply the square root of 2 over delta x square cosinus k delta x. So how is this dispersion relation at low energies? How does it behave? What would be low energies here?
One can minimize the k is somehow small. Yeah. One can compare to the one can linearize the cosines and then it's quadratic by the square root and it becomes a linear relation.
Exactly. So this is like 1/2 k squared delta x squared. That means that discretization drops from the theory. So at low energies, we have that this looks like V of J, some group velocity, where this group velocity is just square root of 1 C0 plus 0. Okay, so that's low energies. That means K is small, or that means that the wavelength is large. It's comparable to the size of your experiment. The other feature that appears here, which is a bit annoying, is the fact that high energies cannot be arbitrarily high. What is the maximum value that you get here for the frequency? So what?
Yes. And the 1 minus cosine is maximum.
So yes.
It is 2.
Yep. So there is a cutoff. Goes by square root of 2 divided by delta x. So it's related to the discretization. So that's simply that it's telling you that you were assuming that the wavelengths were large when doing this discrete model, but now you want to use it for describing very short wavelengths, and that doesn't work. Okay, simply telling you that. That's something that one has to take care of when doing some modeling of these transmission lines. Now you can go to experimental papers and estimate what's VG there. Okay. So you simply have to know what is the typical frequency of a resonator that they get there, and what would be the size of that resonator, which relates to the wavelength, as we're going to see. And this tells you the speed of light that you get, the speed of the waves in this microwave transmission line. And it's not neither very fast, it's not faster than light, of course, but it's also not too small. Okay, it's at most one order of magnitude smaller. Okay. Now, the other thing that you can do is instead of solving this equation in the discrete limit, you can solve it in the continuum limit. Can I erase? No. So you simply realize that phi I plus 1 minus phi 2 phi I minus 1, using that phi I plus minus 1 we have the Taylor expansion of this, and this from the previous equation that we had, this becomes simply the second derivative of the field that's now assumed that is to be smoothly varying and almost continuous. If you do that, you get the same result as here. Second derivative of the field is approximately which is the usual wave equation, where VG has the same definition as you got it before. Okay, so that's a wave equation for the plane waves. Okay, now we are going to use this because it's convenient when you have boundaries. The idea is the same. We are finding solutions of the classical problem. We find out what are the allowed frequencies, and at some point we will replace those frequencies with quantum degrees of freedom. And now I'm going to discuss with you what would be this situation. Okay? You have a transmission line that has been cut. Okay, it has now two boundaries. I'm going to forget about this for a second, so that we only have this segment of superconductor with some length. It's terminated. So what would be your physical boundary conditions? What do you have to ask from that cable, from whatever fields you compute on that cable at the ends of it? We are working with two quantities, voltage and intensities, or flux and charge. So what would be your boundary conditions?
Charge.
Can you know the charge that you have? No. You can have as much Cooper pressure as you want. Then it cannot be a boundary condition because that's something that you don't know a priori. But what can you know about this cable? That current cannot leak, okay? So the current at the boundaries has to be zero. Okay? So we have that I at zero has to be equal to I at L, has to be zero. Okay? And but we are working with flux and charge. How do you translate the boundaries there? What would be the most comfortable way to write the boundary condition in these fields?
Q not the boundaries is here.
That's one possibility. Another one? You remember that we had currents moving on those directions or on those directions, and we had that the current between two inductive segments was of this form, or plus one or minus one. That was this, but this is L0 delta x. Okay? So that was the current along one inductor. Okay? So if you go to this expansion, and you impose that these currents between site 0 and site 1 has to be 0, what does it tell you? Sorry? And what does this mean mathematically? That the derivative of x has to be 0. Okay? So the other possibility is that the derivative of x is 0. So both are okay boundary conditions, okay? You can work with both of them. The problem is that I have been working all the time with wave equations for the field, for the flux, but I haven't studied what happens to the charge or the voltage for that matter. So if you go to, I think, Alessandro Blais' paper, I think in their case they work with the charge. And so they use that you have a certain boundary condition that there. But we are going to work with the wave equation for the flux. And that means we have a different boundary condition. And what you can do now is to think about what are the oscillating solutions that you can impose. Again, so we have the equation would be with this boundary condition has to be equal to zero. And we know that we are looking for stationary solutions, so they are going to have a profile that looks like this. And you can break your head around it, but this, I mean, you know that it's going to be basically sinusoidal functions. So this guy has to have a shape e to the minus I x cosine proportional of kx. And well, this has more or less this form. You start here, go down, and you want to have boundary derivative there zero. So basically, you have that k times l has to be pi n. K is a multiple of this pi l, which is to say that your wavelength is twice the length of the cable. Okay? Can you see it on the back? So this would be the fundamental mode. Has derivative zero on the borders. You can have other modes. I think that was shown better on this transparency slide. Oh no, they used currents anyway. Everybody uses their own conventions, but basically, it would be also this one, or you can have another one, and things like this. So you can have many. So it's not only one. And it basically tells you that you have a number of frequencies that are spaced by a multiple of this quantity. These are different resonator frequencies. The spacing can be very large, can be gigahertz, several gigahertz. And this, it can be experimentally characterized in the way I mentioned before with the LC resonator. I don't know if you see it very clearly, but what our colleagues from Zaragoza did is that they had this one-dimensional transmission line. They sent some field, time-dependent field through, and they study the transmission as a function of the frequency. And they see peaks, okay? This is a logarithmic scale. This is high attenuation outside this resonance. This would be the fundamental resonance, which in voltage would be that one, but in current is this other one. Is this the derivative of the flux in this position, and they have this resonance, they have this other resonance, and they have this other resonance. So you have higher order modes. Okay. Normally, I've never seen more than two or three modes used, except for other very long lines that sometimes are used to show that you can have hundreds of modes. I think Andrew Hawk has a paper on that, or somebody else. But that's something that you can characterize experimentally. And moreover, you can see that it's possible not to have just a homogeneous cable. You can play with the shape of the cable to change the location and the field distribution of the resonances, okay? So I told you that we have a kind of a fake model for the flux and charge, but it's not completely fake, because in the one-dimensional case, this model describes field distributions through the one-dimensional line. For instance, in this experiment, what they have done is they have created a constriction, so the line is homogeneous until it's constrained to a very thin segment. You can still solve the wave equations for these inhomogeneous structures, and But Bourassa and co-workers did it. And the idea is that you can find out what are the fields that you generate. In this case, they have experimentally characterized them. So they have a kind of magnetic microscope, it's a probe that goes down to the cable and measures the magnetic field around it. And what they do is they inject a current to populate the cavity and see what is the field distribution when the cavity resonates with this frequency. And that's what you see here. There is a current going through the system. It's red, it's large, and it has one direction. And what they have done is just to show that what you're measuring is really the intensity distribution, or the current that you're measuring and the direction that it moves through. They have flipped the current source to show that this is related to the input field that they are injecting. So you can measure, you see that these flips, they are artificially induced. They change the sense of the current. So to see that you can, that this is what they measure is the field induced by the external driving. So the model is somehow a toy model, this change inductors, but it describes quite accurately what are the voltages and currents that particles sitting nearby see. So we can use this theory to describe, for instance, how particles would couple to the different waves propagating through the cable and create models for qubits talking to the different resonator modes. Okay, so the last step, so I've shown you the stationary solutions of this chain. The last step is the quantization of these modes, and there is nothing mysterious about it. To show you that these procedures are consistent with each other, the usual way to do it is to take the modes that we have created, which would be your eigenmodes of the problem, and inject them in the inject them in the Lagrangian. So you have this Lagrangian I wrote before. Which I now write it in this form. I haven't yet quantized it. I just write it using this continuous field. And I'm going to expand my field in this orthogonal basis of solutions of stationary states of my resonator field, where each phi of n is a solution that I have computed before, one of these cosines, frequencies, and so on. For just reminding your analysis courses, because they are independent modes, they are going to be orthogonal to each other. So there is a orthogonality relation, and you can choose the normalization here. I'm going to put here. This is going to be smaller, which is the length of my cable. And you put this here because each of these guys is just oscillating in time. The time derivatives are very easy, but you can instead put the dependency here on these guys. assume that instead of this oscillating, this will come out for the time-dependent alphas. And you get the following Lagrangian, which is a sum of oscillators, independent oscillators. Of this form. The charge associated to this flux variable is C0L alpha dot n. And you have a Hamiltonian for all of them. Which you can quantize, okay?
Sorry,
yes.
Right, Lagrange, we assume the a relation between k and omega, right?
Not yet.
To write that omega n there, otherwise how?
Well, this is it comes from the derivative of your modes. Well, I am assuming just that you have the these cosines that I wrote before,
mm-hmm.
and the second derivative or the first derivative and the integral of those modes gives you this contribution here.
So we didn't assume a relation between omega and the k that is inside the cosines. Kind of a dispersed.
It comes out of the shape of your mode.
Okay.
It's assumed, yes.
Yeah.
So this is actually k squared, okay?
I
just wrote it like that because it makes it easier then to realize that you have like an oscillator in this case.
Yeah.
But this comes from replacing the shapes of your eigenmodes in this particular Lagrangian.
Mm-hmm.
Thing is that this is very general, okay? This for any set of modes, you can get something like that. And the only thing is that now we can explicitly write the dependency that comes in front of this. And so this is useful. It's very necessary to estimate coupling strengths and things like that. So we can, first of all, this is a collection of harmonic oscillators. Now we are going to impose that these variables are independent from each other, and all of them are going to be quantum operators, like this. But you can quantize each of these separately, as we have done before. And you get amplitudes and the expressions of Q of n and alpha of n as some quantities. Okay. So you replace this. You replace these expressions, get out what are the alphas to get a diagonalized oscillator, and the outcome is this. Phi of x is the initial condition, phi of nx, normalization, h bar set, an a plus a dagger root, and q of x is this prefactor. It's missing a special derivative here. I think there should be a special derivative here. No, but okay. A dagger minus A. And then square root of H bar Kn over Z. Okay. And the critical point here is that phi goes like 1 over the square root of kn or 1 over the square root of frequency, square root of frequency. Okay. So it's analogous to what happens to the electric and magnetic fields when you quantize them. So they have different dependencies on the frequencies of the field. The other thing that you notice is that Q is an extensive quantity, so it's probably easier when you work with large systems or infinitely systems to work with the density. And everything is consistent in terms of units. For instance, you can take this expression and prove that the commutation relation between phi and rho is the right one, it's a delta. And the most important thing is that now you can compute things like the voltage that is generated by the cable along its line, okay? Which is something that we are going to use when estimating what happens to a qubit inside the transmission line. So far, so good. Okay. I didn't lose you, right? It's not a very complicated derivation. This is just bookkeeping. And I'm going to do exactly the same calculation that we did for the LC resonator. Everything is on the notes on the web in case you miss something from the screen, the blackboard. So we're going to compute what is the voltage along the line. And we assume that there are no fancy contributions, so this is just like this. Voltage difference. And because we have a bunch of independent harmonic oscillators, and each of them oscillates with its own frequency omega n, this is nothing but H bar. Okay, so this has its expression. We have moved from being 1 over square root of omega to having square root of omega, because this has to be compensated by that. One thing that you can realize is that this is simply 1 over C0 rho x. So it's the usual relation that we would expect for a capacitor. But the important thing is that we can now put numbers as before, because we can estimate what are these quantities in an experiment. So we can design a resonator. We can decide what is going to be the impedance of the cable, what is going to be the length, and what is going to be the field generated by the different modes. You can put numbers using the normalization, for instance, for the first mode. It has to be normalized. This gives you a factor pi half that you have to put inside of phi. And that means that the field goes, the 0-point fluctuations of the field of the first mode go like pi over 2L h bar z pi over L, and then the frequency of the mode, which can be whatever. So this pi over L comes from the k of the fundamental mode. This pi 2 over L comes from the shape of phi of 1, cosinus divided by normalization factor. And then you have the H-bar set, the impedance that you engineer for this circuit. Typical values of set are around between 50 and 100. So let's put numbers there, and you get something like this would be 2.5 microvolts for omega of 8 gigahertz and set 50 ohm, which doesn't tell you much. So what we can do is we can put a charge in there. And this is of the order of 4, 10 to the 9 gigahertz. If I even make numbers wrong. So this can be a huge energy. We are not going to go to those limits because this is too large. But this tells you that because the photons and other circuits are made of the same constituents, which are electrons, you can have a very strong coupling between light and whatever matter you engineer for this field. Okay? So we stop here. We'll see you on Monday at 10:15, if I am not wrong. Okay? Yeah.